Showers this evening, some with a risk of thunder. Overnight lows of 8 to 11 degrees. Now up to date on News Talk.
The Football Show on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. The greatest football partnership since Jeff and Heskey.
I'm prepared to do anything I can. Well, do it then.
What about your start to the game?
It wasn't bad, was it?
Why should it be an honest answer be a mistake?
How can a modern day manager not have a mobile phone?
Why should he?
All right, welcome along to Thursday's Football Show. Nathan and Kev with you until 10 o'clock. 53106 is the text number. Live Premier League back and off the ball this Sunday. We have Leicester City against Newcastle from the King Power Stadium. Stephen Doyle and Brian Kerr will be at that. Leicester, a very good team to go and watch.
Yeah, very
Newcastle,
good.
Not so much.
No, I don't know what you're expecting there. I would imagine Leicester will do what they do. 5-4-1 system, sit in, try and suck the life out of the game and then perhaps maybe score from a set piece or on a counter-attack.
Jamie Vardy averaging 20 touches of the ball per game.
Brilliant, isn't it? But that's his game. That's what he's done. My brother played alongside him at Fleetwood when he was coming through, and he said to me even at the time when he knew him, he just said, like, ridiculous to play against when my brother was playing non-league as well. Unbelievable pace, but doesn't necessarily get involved even at that level. And that's what he's built the career on. It's been incredible, his rise, the way he's come from non-league football over in England to where he is.
You're not a fan of his personality, but would you come around now and admit that Brendan Rodgers is a good coach?
I've never said he wasn't a good coach.
Okay.
I've constantly said that he's actually a brilliant coach. I think he's brilliant with how he sets sides up. If you look at someone like Raheem Sterling, who's the lad that was at Celtic that we had at Swansea and had at come from Chelsea, Scott Sinclair, he would be another player who he got so much out of with. Basically saying, look, you don't necessarily need to get the ball to your feet the whole time. Sprint off defenders, run off shoulders. And that was what I always admired about how he got the best out of players like that. And he is a brilliant coach, yeah.
Top four this season?
No, I don't think so.
Why?
Well, I don't know if they're going to have the consistency come the end of the season to maintain. We wrote them off winning the Premier League, so we all know anything's possible in that regard. But I think Arsenal have got a better squad. I think Tottenham will eventually start to come good. I think they've got a better squad of players as well. And I think that the rest of the sides have just got a bit too much for them. But I seriously think they could go top six. I seriously think they can push on for top six and finish in there.
The way Where they're going. Are you on James Maddison, my favourite player in the Premier League? Yeah. He is...
I play for Ireland as well, mate. Imagine if you play for
Ireland. Imagine. We should go over and beg him to play.
Yeah.
Will you go over and lead the delegation?
I'm at the game, so I have to.
Please come and do a job for us. The gap that has been left by Jack Grealish.
Well, if he
by Declan
to,
Rice.
He doesn't want to, doesn't he?
Beg him.
No, you're all right.
You wouldn't do that?
Why would you want to beg someone to play for Ireland?
Because look how good he is.
Would you?
Look how talented he is.
Yeah. Oh, he's a talented
player. And he's funny.
Talented player.
There's not many funny footballers out there, Kev. You know that.
Is he? Funny.
He is.
A bit of controversy last week around that bag that he wore.
Did you see? So this was essentially a see-through Louis Vuitton bag?
Yeah. Yeah, see-through.
How much did it cost?
£6,500. Was it $6,500 or £6,500? I think it might have been pounds, actually.
Pittance.
Six
What's
half,
he on a week?
£6,500.
50, 60 grand a week?
I would imagine probably, yeah. 40, 50, 60, whatever it would be. Ah, Nath, come on.
It's like buying a rucksack for, you know, us normal folk.
Nah.
Looks good.
I think if I was in the dressing room, I'd have a word. I probably would have had a chat with him. I would have done, yeah.
Why? What's wrong with his see-through Louis Vuitton bag?
I just think it's not.
Is this not sending a good example to the young players of what they could achieve? Like when Roy Keane signed Dwight York for Sunderland, and Dwight York would rock up to training in his white Porsche, and all the young lads are looking at it going, oh my God, if I work hard at my game, I too could have a white Porsche someday like Dwight York. Inspirational figure.
Yeah, that's true, but I think then it gets to the stages that you're at that financial stability, or you've got financial stability so early in a young person's career, then that once you get that car, is your mind then...
Oh, there it is there if you're watching online.
Yeah, does your mind... Is it focused elsewhere then? You know,
is he just having a laugh? Now, granted, he's spending a lot of money to have a laugh.
Yeah, I'm
just
I'm
thinking
sure he is.
I'm going to get slaughtered online for this, but it'll be worth it.
I'm sure he is. I think you're right. I think he's having a laugh. I think his teammates, the lads, would have taken the piss out of him, and he would have had a crack with it, a bit of a laugh, like you're saying. But it's just, In my mind, you're overstepping the mark a little bit. And again, many wouldn't agree with it. Nath is it's so out of touch. It's so not in keeping with supporters that are bringing the kids and they're struggling to bring. You know, there's a family of four that might go to a game. They're struggling to afford to come to games, and that's. I know you're saying he's entitled to spend his money any way he can. I just think it's just
he might donate half his wages every week to charity. We don't know.
Well, that's unlikely, isn't it? Let's be honest about that now. And I'm sure he does things to charity. I've got no doubts. He's a great guy. He's a wonderful human being. To quote,
you have a nice car. Did you when you were buying your nice car when you were a footballer? Did you think maybe I should buy a cheaper car because, and give a few tickets to the. Poor folk around Everton who want to come to the matches?
No, it wasn't.
Of course you didn't. So why should he think any differently?
Yeah, I get your point. I personally wouldn't agree. I think I would have been in maybe dressing rooms most of the time where it would have been, you know, you would have had the odd lad that's coming in a bloody Lamborghini or a Porsche or whatever it would be. But he just, I again.
What was your flashiest buy?
I think I told the story.
Bear in mind, Leon Osman is coming on shortly, so he might
When I went to Sunderland
stories.
And I'd played and I'd started to do quite well, I got an offer, I bought a Jag. Oof. So I bought a Jag, which is, it wasn't me, a Jag XKR, the old XKR, really, really nice car, was really nice car. And
what year was this?
About 2001, I would say.
So brand new, cash up front.
No, it wasn't brand new. It was maybe a couple of years old.
Sorry. So your flashiest purchase was a second-hand car?
Yeah, probably would have been, yeah. And Quinny wasn't having it at all.
What was Quinny driving? Land Rover, steady.
No, I don't think he was.
He probably had his own personal driver.
No.
Do many of the players have their own personal driver?
Not at all.
Appropriately enough, considering some of the stories today, mightn't be the worst idea.
I know. You can't even joke about that, really, can you? No, lads would have had drivers. Yeah, Kevin Campbell used to have a driver that would have drove him. There was a few lads that did, yeah, over the time. And again, I mean, it's lads that would have been in longer journeys as well, that wouldn't have to do longer journeys to and from. I actually had a lad that would do a bit of driving from me from Manchester to Hull when I was at Hull for a while. The journey, kind of a kip in the car or something like that.
Michael Owen used to have the helicopter, which would bring him from Merseyside to Newcastle.
Yeah.
When he was in recently, there's Kev's Jag, parked.
Yeah, it was a bit like that, yeah.
Was that it? That colour?
It was silver like that.
Yeah. James Bond
silver.
Style.
It was a great car, it was, but Quinny put me in my box straight away. Quinny just said to me, Kev, it's not you, mate. He said, it's not you. And I had it.
But it could be me now.
I had it about 6 months and I got rid of it, yeah.
You should have stood up for yourself.
And it wasn't me. I didn't feel comfortable driving in it. People
look shit hot.
People look at you, and it's just like, I saw him in his. And I just
wanted people to look at you. You were a Premier League footballer.
I didn't at all.
But in fairness, around Sunderland, if people saw you,
I didn't.
I'd say they weren't going past. There's Kev. It was like, your man is driving a Jag after what he's done.
It wasn't so much like that actually. But it just wasn't me. I didn't feel comfortable at all. I genuinely didn't. And needless to say, I got rid.
I always judged Martin Skrtel, and this says more about me than Martin Skrtel. We were at a Ireland game in Slovakia, Zelina was it, and Martin Skrtel rocked out after the game with his pink, the brightest shade of pink you have ever seen, Louis Vuitton bag. I just thought, Martin, you've got the skinhead, you're the tough guy centre back.
Yeah.
It's just it's not fitting in with your image.
Loads of lads had the Louis Vuitton bags, though. That was kind of a thing.
Do they hold their value? So, like, are we laughing at James Maddison now, but in 10 years' time, that bag will be worth 20 grand? Well, an investment.
Depends what he puts in it. Does he put his
boots in it?
His boots or whatever it will be. He probably just abuse it even more, just use the bag as for anything. And
the other thing with a bag like that is, he can't really rock up to the game this weekend with that bag.
I sit in studio, obviously, a lot with yourself and Joe and the lads, right? You lads would be the biggest big-time arseholes as players. If you were Premier League players, you'd be arseholes. You would. Because even when you're talking to me now, oh, Kev, it could be you. You could have the... Like you're taking your eye off the ball if that's what you're actually aspiring to get. You're aspiring to get that flash car, that 100-grand motor. You know, if that's... But
you can have it all, Kev.
Can you have it all?
Because you can relate it to the more successful I am in my career, the more money I will earn, so therefore I'm going to work harder.
I get that theory. If that's your motivation, fair play to you. I've got no issues with that at
Absolutely.
All as well. But, as I'm saying before, I think certain lads that have been that way... We had a lad that signed for Wigan. So he signed for Wigan from a lower league club within... Within a few days, he had a Range Rover and a Merc.
Hunty.
Range Rover and a Merc. It was at Wigan. Hunty didn't play for Wigan. So So he has these two cars signed in. He was probably on about $4,000 a week when he came to Wigan as well. Simply, you know, on what do you call it, on high purchase or whatever.
That's
it would
what
be.
I was going to say.
Yeah, and it was like, mate, what are you doing? Like, you're a young lad. He's not even established. Never played a Premier League game, and that was his motivation when he signed. Just got a Premier League footballer now. That's it. And that can't be your motivation.
How did he get on as a Premier League footballer? Well,
yeah, exactly. Well, there you go. Yeah, he had a good career. He did. He was a good player. But does that take your eye off the ball? And personally, I think it does. I think it does. And the lads, as I said, what I was going to say before, the lads that are like that, that would constantly edge towards having that nature. I feel as though that they maybe slacked off in training, weren't quite at it when you kind of needed them in moments in training, pre-season, and I think that would then come across to a lad when you needed them on a Saturday or whenever you had that game that was coming around.
Who was the flashiest player you ever played with?
One lad had a driver and had a Rolls Royce.
And a driver with the Rolls Royce?
Who was that? Why should I? I don't need to.
Because
tell
that's
you.
What makes it an interesting story.
Does it? It's wrong though, isn't it? Because then you're.
Which club?
He was actually a great lad, great crack actually.
Oh yeah. Amir Zaki.
Amir Zaki used to have a white Rolls Royce actually. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
He had a white.
But he deserved it.
Yeah.
Remember that run of form he went on?
Yeah.
Probably tripled his wages in the space of a month.
Yeah, but I think we only had him on loan, didn't we? I think he was only on loan with us at that time. But anyway, yeah, Amir had a white Rolls Royce.
Why not?
Why not? Yeah. Why not?
Seamus Coleman speaking back in 2016. You can find this full article on offtheball.com. If I see a footballer with a Louis Vuitton wash bag, I wonder what that does to others. If you're the only young lad in the changing room without one of them, you feel the pressure that you need to go out and get one, even if you don't want one or even like one. That's what I think is wrong with football. It's completely wrong. Your job is to train well and play well on Saturday and do well week in, week out. That's your job. Your job isn't to be going out and buying the best of everything just because someone else is.
Yeah, but that's the culture that's created, that somebody then can... I've heard it as well, players on the pitch that will be constantly... The term would be cashing somebody off, telling them that, look, mate, do you want to come and be my gardener? I pay my gardener more than I pay you. Things like this. This would be fairly common with certain players that would have been on the pitch. And that then, I feel, as though sets in across younger players. That's the attitude that a younger player would have. If they're looking up to the peers, and the peer or the more experienced players in the dressing room are acting like that, then that then creates such a bad environment, I think, for the working environment day to day. And I think then a player then, or the younger players, younger generation that's coming through, all of a sudden then become arseholes. And that is the common... I think it's certainly a misconception of a modern-day Premier League player is they're all arseholes because they're all flash, they're all this, and a majority actually aren't. But that, what I'm talking there, what you're saying there about James Maddison, that is the stereotypical flash footballer. And I think that isn't the norm. It isn't the norm, but it stands out when it actually happens.
Difficult position for Seamus Coleman with that sort of attitude, and he's very much had that. Everything's about character. It's about making the very best of your career. Yeah. Train as hard as you can. Get what you can out of it. He's the captain of Everton. He's 30. Mm. They've just spent hundreds of millions of euros on young, technically brilliant, tricky, flashy footballers.
Yeah.
And he's now sitting in a dressing room going, I know exactly what type of dressing room I want. I want a dressing room full of character, full of people you can rely on a Saturday.
Yeah.
And he's looking around going, oof, they mightn't have that. Can one figure in a dressing room, can he influence, we're going to talk more about Everton with Leon Osman shortly, can one figure have that level of influence that actually he can get across, this is the way this dressing room is, or does football change so quickly now that it's actually impossible?
It depends what the lads who are a little bit flashy, because I had it when I was at Preston, you know, and when I signed for Preston, my first pro contract was £90 a week. My first wage in professional football when I was a YT was £29.50 a week. So, but there were still flashy lads in the dressing room then when I was at Preston in the professional dressing room. So whichever level I've played at, you would have had that lad. And I'm sure any sportsman and woman would appreciate that. They would have had it at every level, no matter what sport they're playing in. But I read that interview with Seamus Coleman, and Seamus is right in terms of, he wants everyone, you know, certainly pulling together, pulling the weight in the training ground. But if you will always give a little bit of leeway for someone. I always talk about Tommy Gravesen, and Tommy Gravesen was a bit of a loose cannon. He was certainly, he did things differently than the way we would have all trained. But if you're producing it on the pitch and you're producing it on the training ground, fair play to you, it's thumbs up all the way as far as I'd be concerned. And that's the sort of thing that, if you're talking about Everton, a lot of those players that you would consider maybe flash, these really good players, these good attacking players that you've brought in, aren't producing it. Everton aren't producing it at the moment. So that's where the extra scrutiny would come onto those players because of that.
That image of James Maddison's bag isn't the only embarrassing image that has surfaced in the last while. Enda, who should have been working for the last 2 hours, has actually done some of his best ever work and has photoshopped Kevin Kilbane onto the Dancing on Ice set. That is post-gym Kevin Kilbane. Whose body is that Kev's head is now on? No idea, because whoever it is in good shape.
Yeah.
Serious shape.
I'm not in that shape, let me tell you. Yeah.
Like, do you think you'll get to that stage that you can slide along on one foot?
I was going to say to you, do you think I would look that elegant on ice?
No.
No.
So,
that's a good
John
answer.
John Giles was making the point earlier that he wasn't impressed with David James. Embarrassing was the word he used.
Did he?
Strictly.
I hadn't seen him. I've not seen David James. So.
He made the point that he likes the lads who are funny. You know, because there is always room in these for a sort of novelty act.
Are you saying don't take it too seriously?
So, and like, be the worst. So, who was the girl last year? Gemma. She's on like Towie or one of them. Gemma Collins,
good.
And she was terrible, but people kept her in because
they wanted to see her fall.
They wanted to see her fall flat on her face all the time.
Yeah.
And there was the guy, Ian Beale from EastEnders. He was the one who was telling you last night, one of the greatest TV moments of all time, one of the first series. He's doing a little swing around and he lets go and he's meant to turn to his left, but he can't move. So he just goes straight off through the entrance. Literally, just goes straight off the ice. And then the people behind the scenes have to turn him around and push him back onto the ice again.
You would piss your side. That's exactly what you would do. If I did that, that would be the greatest moment that you could ever see, wouldn't it?
But it'd be one of your greatest ever moments. And I'm saying that you need to find a thing. You don't want to be just grand. You don't want to be like 4 out of 10. How seriously are you going to take this? Because let's be honest, I was watching Strictly the other night, and they were very harsh on their scores. Like, there's people getting 2 and 3.
Yeah.
What if you, in the first night, you're getting 2s and 3s? Like, are you going to be motivated to go back? Because there's not much you can do in the space of a week.
Better. Well, I am limited on the ice.
Limited?
Leon Osman will be coming on in a short while, and he may tell a story, but I've actually ice skated with Leon Osman on a pre-season trip to Houston. But this is for another day, I think, as well. But anyway, Liam might tell it. But anyway, I think if I was getting criticised by the judges and they give me a lot of abuse, it would serve as motivation. Yes, it would.
They have got rid of the really nasty guy.
Have they?
Yeah.
They're bound to have a nasty guy on.
John Barrowman has come in to replace him.
I'd say he'd be quite nasty.
No, he's all frills and dancing and
is he
happy with life?
Is he?
No, this guy was. They had to get rid of him.
Did they?
Nah, he was. You couldn't be having that on. He was cruel.
Was he?
Verging on. Which wouldn't be fair on you, Kev.
Would he not?
So, Barrowman, I think, is going to like you.
Right.
Have you met Philip Schofield yet?
No.
Holly Willoughby?
No.
It's all ahead of you.
It is. It's going to be.
You have no time for us.
It's going to be. Well, exactly. Well, I'd always have time for you, Nathan, as you know.
Thanks, Kev.
You and I will be going to the All Ireland next year, All Ireland final, watching Mayo win. We know that. But
Eddie from the Cronas.
Yeah,
singing the Isle Triangle.
Yeah, exactly. We'll sing it. Probably we'll sing the green and red of Mayo for him. But anyway, no, I'll always have time for you, Nathan, no matter who it is. So just because I could be in the company of Holly Willoughby and Philip Schofield, that wouldn't matter to me. It wouldn't matter in my eyes to me.
When is the first night then? When are you first going to be live on television on ice skates?
I think. Right, let me just see here. One sec. I'll just get me.
It's all planned out.
It's the 5th of January. Sunday the 5th of January, yeah.
FA Cup weekend.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. 4th and 5th of January.
No football to distract.
Yeah.
Brilliant. All right, so that's exciting.
What do you think,
I'm thinking we're there.
Are you?
100%. Every week.
So you can come over, is that what you're saying then?
Anyways, for a Premier League game on a Sunday, we'll just get the old train up.
Yeah.
We'll go be there to Tricolours.
Well, no, it's FA Cup weekend, so there'll be no Premier League.
We'll fly over. Don't you worry about that.
Yeah.
100%.
Tricolours,
we'll expense it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we'll have the tricolours there 100%. Post-Brexit. The big question, a lot of people are concerned, what about the dog? What's going to happen to the dog
during
the ice skating?
Having to get him all sorted, no. Well, I'll only be training for a couple of hours a day, so there'll be times he's... Well,
a couple of hours a day?
Yeah.
I don't think so. You need to be doing about 6 hours a day.
No, I've got to. They want me to do 30 hours. I've got to do 30 hours on the ice before I go with my partner.
You need to be doing about 6 hours a day. Trust me.
Well, have you ever ice skated?
We'll get Mairead Ronan
on.
She won Dancing with the Stars last year.
Yeah.
And I'm fairly sure, just for dancing, she was doing 5 or 6 hours a day.
Have you ever ice skated?
Yeah, and I'm terrible.
Right, no,
there's nothing worse in the world than going ice skating on a rink with loads of children who are falling over in front of you. You can barely stand, and the blades are getting close to their head.
You usually get half an hour session on the ice, wouldn't you?
And I'm bloody wrecked.
And it hurts your feet.
Yeah.
How can you spend 6 hours on the ice? It's not possible to do. Your body and your feet.
Well, then you need to spend 2 hours on the ice and 4 hours dancing.
Yeah, well, that's a possibility. Yeah,
right.
That's a possibility. And 2 hours in the gym a day. I've got to tone up a little bit, you know what I mean? To quote the great Nathan Murphy, shit, man, you've got to go to the gym.
Neil Osman is listening in. We're going to get the inside story on their skating life together next.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power, the greatest football partnership since Jeff and Heskey.
This week on News Talk,
we've got loads of e-scooters to give away.
All this week on News Talk Breakfast and the Hard Shoulder.
Thanks to appliancesdelivered.ie.
Ireland's online home for appliances, smart technology and much more. Only on News Talk.
Molly, the Museum of Literature Ireland, is a new home for the world's greatest storytellers. Discover Ireland's rich literary heritage here in the original home of UCD, the beautiful Newman House on Dublin's St. Stephen's Green. Experience immersive exhibitions, view treasures from our partners, the National Library of Ireland, or relax amid the birdsong in our tranquil gardens and cafe. Book your visit at molly.ie.
International football is more exciting than ever.
Remember that first time on the terraces, where it all began. The heroes, the villains, the highs, the lows. All the while, you were learning. Now use that knowledge on Football Index. Join tens of thousands of fans trading the world's top players. Football Index, the game changed. App available, 18 plus, terms and conditions apply, gamble responsibly.
FBD Hotels and Resorts present our newest addition, The Heritage. The perfect location for your next conference or event. Situated between Kildare Village, the Curragh and Portlaoise, it's easily accessible from just about everywhere. Less than an hour from Dublin, just off the M7 motorway at Junction 15. Make an inquiry today and learn about our exciting recent refurbishment. The Heritage, your own kind of perfect. Discover more at theheritage.com.
No matter where I wander, I'm still haunted by
Christy Moore.
The wise men came stern and stern.
Live at the INEC Friday, March 13th.
Sail on to be.
Tickets from €42 are on sale now, maybe subject to fees.
Swap winter chills for stateside thrills with up to €100 off return flights to North America when you book with Aer Lingus by September 30th. Spot the Space Needle in Seattle, see the stars in LA, or explore Minneapolis-St. Paul's iconic music scene. Wherever you're heading this November, don't miss out on a great deal to kickstart your adventure. Smart saves up to €100 by booking now. Smart flies Aer Lingus. Book now at aerlingus.com. Offer subject to conditions and availability.
Tuesday, October 8th, the Republic of Ireland take on Ukraine in a huge Women's Euro 2021 qualifier. In partnership with 20x20, we're asking you to help the team and make history by setting a new attendance record in Talis Stadium. Kickoff is 7:30 p.m. and tickets are just €5, while under-16s go free. Show your stripes for the girls in green and new manager Fiera Pau in her first match at Talis Stadium. Tickets on sale now at fai.ie/tickets. Booking fee applies.
Have a great evening with itsforwomen.ie. Don't live your life on hold. Get a quote now at itsforwomen.ie and see why we're trusted by over 130,000 women in Ireland.
Off the Ball. This is News Talk.
Welcome back to Thursday's football show. Nathan and Kev in studio. 53106 is the text number. You can send a comment on any of our social channels. And Everton legend Leon Osman is on the line. Evening, Leon. How's it going?
Good evening, fellas.
Looking well, Leon. Looking well there.
dressed up just for you, Kev.
Good man, good man.
So then, Leon, we'll get on to Everton, but word has it, you have first-hand experience of Kevin Kilbane's skating talent.
I do, and of all the things Kev could probably do, I'm really amazed he's chosen to go on the ice. It was about 15 years ago now, Kev, wasn't it? And okay, I think it was fair to say we'd had a couple of drinks before we went on there, which probably isn't wise.
Yeah, that's true. Can't condone Kev's that, Leon. Skating,
well, what I remember of Kev going on the ice, it was one footstep, his feet were in the air, blood all down of his arm, and then straight back off again. So I'm amazed after seeing that, Kev, you're actually going to go back on the ice.
And we actually had the club doctor. I think JT's still at Everton now, isn't he, Ozzy? Yeah. It was JT.
No, he's not anymore.
Oh, is he not? But he was the club doctor. It was his first trip away. It was his first pre-season with us, and he was just looking at me in amazement, like, what are you doing? You're a professional footballer. What on earth are you doing on ice skates? And to be fair to Ozzy, he was very good. Ozzy was skating everywhere, you know, pirouettes and everything on the ice. He was flying. But the club doctor could not believe the stupidity on me getting on the ice.
Why didn't they ask you to do dancing on ice, Leon? Everton legend, England international. Did you turn it down?
I'm still waiting on the call. Kev gets all the best calls these days. I'm booked in to mind his dog for the next month.
So literally, you walk on the ice, you go head over heels, you somehow, and you were laughing earlier when I was talking about the potentially life-changing injuries you could suffer.
Yeah.
You somehow rip your arm apart with the skate.
Well, it was a minor cut on my elbow, that's what it was.
It wasn't the skate. He went that high into the air, the impact of him landing on the floor just bashed his elbow up, and he didn't actually stand up to get back off the ice. He crawled.
That's true, I think,
Right, how's news of Kilbane's dancing and ice stint gone down in the former Everton players' WhatsApp group?
Oh, fantastically well, to be honest. We've got a sweep going. How many weeks in before he goes out? Everyone's desperate to get one.
Very harsh. Let us see.
We could spend all night talking about Kilbane on the ice, but we should talk about Everton because it's been another really slow start to the season. Just the 2 wins from their opening 6 games, just the 5 goals from their opening 6 matches, and it feels, after all the money they spent during the summer, Leon, that already there's some pressure coming on Marco Silva. He just about did enough in the last 3 months of last season to win the fans over and get that investment and the opportunity to spend that money. What's gone wrong? Why haven't they been able to kick on with all that attacking talent they brought in this summer?
Well, again, you know, you talk about the end of last season and the momentum and the results that Marco Silva and the Everton team got going into the close season. But it was mostly down to that home form. That home form was magnificent, beating the likes of Manchester United and the other top team, Chelsea and Arsenal and Liverpool, all came to Goodison Park, and they were all sent packing on their way pretty much. And, you know, there's so much reliance on Marco Silva's team to win their home games because the away form has been poor. But the optimism was there going into this season, that going with that confidence that the season could be started well home and away. But again, the away form at the start of this year has left a lot to be desired. Going away to Aston Villa, poor performance and getting beat against a newly promoted club, then getting beat away at Bournemouth, and then suddenly there's an awful lot of pressure on your home form. Again, you feel like you have to win your home game. So one poor game at home against Sheffield United, and suddenly it's the pressure mounts.
Can I just ask you, Leon, about that away form then? What in your mind then is the reason why Everton can't seem to get that away form right?
Well, do you know what, Kev? I think I'd had a call to go help out if I knew the actual answer. They just seem a bit soft away from home. You know, you go there and you watch the team and you know yourself that teams that generally do well away from home have got a real good spine of attitude, the leaders, the character. That you go there and you by hook or by crook, you don't get beat. You know, you might not come away with a victory, but you don't get beaten. The opening day against Crystal Palace, I thought that, you know, that may be a sign of things to come, despite the attacking prowess in that game not being great. But since then, I just seem a little bit soft away from home. And certainly when Everton go a goal down at the moment, you don't see the ability from the team to recover. And that's been an issue.
One of the other issues is, well, clearly on one end they're not scoring enough goals, but at the other end, the amount of goals they're conceding from set pieces. So since the start of last season, they've conceded 20 goals from corners and free kicks, more than any other Premier League side. But you were looking at this earlier, Kevin. It's not just since the start of last season. This is a trait of Marco Silva teams, that basically his side, since he's come into the Premier League, concede a goal from set pieces, not including penalties, every second game.
Yeah.
86 matches, 43 goals conceded from set pieces.
Yeah, as you're saying, it's not just to Everton, where, considering that they've got decent attackers of the ball, if you look at Yerry Mina, if you look at Michael Keane, they have got a little bit of height in the side. That is a terrible stat for Marco Silva. And I'd seen his sides at Hull do the same. I'd seen his sides at Watford do the same. 43 goals in 86 games, that's extremely poor. And the other managers that would be around him have got nowhere near that sort of level. So that's something that Everton, when you watch them, they look like they're going to concede from every wide free kick and every corner that's going into the penalty area.
What's your sense of it, Leon? And you'd be around the club quite a bit in terms of how responsible Marco Silva is for that on the training ground. Is he very much involved in that set piece setup, or is he trusting his coaches and maybe putting his trust in the wrong people?
Well, ultimately, you know, whoever takes set pieces, whether they spend 3 hours on them or 3 minutes on them, the buck always stops with the manager, and you know, he's the person who ends up holding the responsibility. But Everton and even the previous clubs, we're just talking about the conceding the goals. You know, Watford and Hull. Generally likes to do zonal marking, and there's been a lot of talk with Pep Guardiola does zonal marking as well. And you know, Manchester City's percentage of conceding goal is right up there. And at the moment, you just look across the league, and generally, zonal marking doesn't seem to work. But that's the way Marco Silva likes to do it. And you know, I think there was a period at the start of last season, Everton conceded a lot of goals, but then for about 3 months, that seemed to be shored up. It seemed as if the amount of time spent on the training field really was paying off. But you know, the start of the season, again, conceding a lot of goals. And you know, with letting the likes of Phil Jagielka leave the club, not being able to get Kurt Zouma back after thinking that potentially that was going to be a deal done. And suddenly, you know, your options at the back are not what they were. And you know, I'm thinking maybe that might have something to do with it.
And it does feel as though he finds himself in a very difficult situation with this squad, because there's a lot of leaks suddenly coming out of that Everton dressing room. And you would imagine, and I would assume, that when you have issues like this from set pieces, it takes a lot of work on the training ground. It's pretty dull. It's not very interesting, but you're standing there, you're working on your positioning, you put the hours in and you hope that you get the rewards, and suddenly you're better at defending set pieces. Yet one of the stories coming out of the dressing room is that the players aren't happy with the length of the training sessions, that they go on too long, that he isn't able to motivate his players during those training sessions.
But I think you would have had that thought, and Leon and I would have experienced it. Certainly if you're looking at a manager like David Moyes, when we used to lose a game at a weekend, or if we lost a game at a weekend, you know full well kind of the week you were going to get, extra time in the training ground, extra time on set pieces, extra time on the shape of the team. It's kind of a standard thing, really. That's what most clubs would do, because you're trying to rectify it, aren't you? You're trying to get it right. And yeah, it isn't the ideal training that you would want to be doing day in, day out, because sometimes, certainly now the way that the game is, how physical the game is, you'd feel as though you need to be working on the physical side of it more often in shorter, maybe bursts. So I can imagine, but that's just a standard. That's the way that it is. Everton are conceding badly, or conceding goals at a bad rate from corners and set pieces. It needs to be sorted. Now, just touch on something that Leon said there about managers that like to deploy a zonal system. I'm not in favour of it personally, but if it's done right, then it works. But clearly Everton aren't working on that system, and it doesn't look from my eye watching them that they're actually covering each other's back in the zones across the 18-yard box, and that's where they're coming unstuck a lot of the time.
Leon, from Marco Silva's point of view, when he's seeing these stories coming out about the unhappiness with the training sessions. He likes the players to stay in a hotel. It's all this kind of stuff that when you're winning matches, literally nobody ever hears of. But now that they're losing them, the players obviously feel that, well, and maybe this actually says a lot about Everton as well. And it's something every time we talk to Seamus Coleman after an Everton game, if they've lost, and he'll always come out and he'll do his interview and he'll talk about the character within the squad. That actually, the very fact that these sort of stories are coming out would make you question the character in that Everton squad.
Well, they're certainly not the stories that you want to be leaked. You know, the manager won't be best pleased that this type of thing is getting out. But you're right. You know, it's all about winning and losing. If things are going well, then the players don't seem to mind doing anything. The attention to detail, the amount of time spent is all helping you to win games. But, you know, if you're finding yourself out there for long periods, say on a Friday when you play Saturday, and then you don't win, you're always looking for an excuse. And if it's, you know, that I was a bit tired from all the standing round the day before, you know, then players will try to use that. Kev was always trying to use that, weren't you, Kev, the day before a game when we were doing set pieces? That you were always stood around a bit too long, but you were generally on
That's because I wasn't in the team, Ozzy, that was why.
I was going to say, you were generally on the bib team, weren't you, helping us do set pieces?
They've obviously spent an insane amount of money as well over the last few years, and haphazard at best. Some players have worked. Jordan Pickford for $25 million established himself as the England goalkeeper. Yeah. Richarlison, maybe, is the jury still out on Richarlison? Generally puts in a good shift, contributes with goals, but like $45 million on Gylfi Sigurdsson, who didn't make it at Tottenham, has probably shown why he hasn't had that level of consistency for a top six club. Andre Gomez, when we saw him at the start of last season, raving about his consistency, that this was the player that would unlock everything for Everton. And he's now been sort of drawn into this malaise of some games he does it, some games he doesn't. Like, from your point of view, Leon, like, what snaps Everton out of this cycle that they can put together a consistent level of performance over the course of the season?
Well, you need someone within the dressing room to snap you out of it. You need a good performance. You need leaders within the dressing room driving the team forward at every single moment of every single game. And, I think Fabian Delph was a great addition over the summer, having lost Phil Jagielka, to get that experience and that character and that kind of leader out there on the field, because I think he will help. But you're right, but the word you use with Everton and the players at the moment is consistency, because, you know, you mentioned Richarlison. Blows hot and cold. Some weeks he's terrific. Some weeks he's anonymous. And, you know, pretty much all the players you went through there, the Everton team, that consistency, getting them to perform. We know that they can perform at a really high level. You know, Gylfi Sigurdsson is probably the highest profile at the moment, that it's just probably not doing enough out there on the field to justify his central role. He's number 10, you know, and you need him to do an awful lot going forward and defensively, creating goals, scoring goals. And he's just not in good form at the moment. When you see, as you did at the end of last season, that these players playing with confidence, these players playing with momentum, you know, breathing that from each other, feeling it, being led by players on the field, then you get a really high level of performance. But at the moment, it just seems like everyone's waiting for somebody else in the team to drive the team forward so they can all follow.
Leon, across the course, you know, you've been around Everton basically your whole life, really, certainly your adult life anyway, but across the course of the Premier League, only Tony Cotti, Andriy Kanchelskis, the Yak, Romelu Lukaku have scored more than 15 goals in a season. Romelu Lukaku is the only player that's actually broke 20 for Everton. So, you know, we're going back a long time here, and I'm saying that you've played in a lot of sides where it has had to be maybe sitting and maybe soak up a bit of pressure in games. But how much of a problem is that for Everton, given, as Nathan spoke about before, the amount of money that they've spent, that there's nobody within Everton's ranks that you can guarantee is going to get you 15, 20 goals?
Well, you're right. It's a huge problem. And, you know, you talk about the players that have done it, and I was playing there for 14, 15 seasons, and I only had two players in that list that managed to score over 15 goals. It shows the importance, and it comes with expectations as well. You know, Everton now, having got the new owners talking about a new stadium, they're spending more money than we ever dreamed possible going back years ago. I mean, David Moyes was managing on a shoestring and getting players in, whereas Everton are now spending money, have been spending money for 3 or 4 seasons. So the expectations are higher. The expectations are to be battling for top six and, you know, maybe in a year or two's time, battling for top form and winning trophies. But unfortunately, you need a 15, 20 goal a season man to be able to do that. And, you know, there's been a bit of expectation on Calvert-Lewin's shoulders, but he hasn't quite materialised in that way. He's a good all-round player, not quite clinical enough that you're expecting to get your 20 goals a season. And Moise Keane, who showed a lot of promise over in Italian football, is just as most young players do when they come over to the Premier League, looks like he's going to take a month or two to get to the pace of the Premier League.
Seamus Coleman was given the captaincy at the start of the season. Now, how much you read into that, considering Phil Jagielka had been the club captain for previous seasons and was in and out of the side, but it feels as though that these are a big few weeks for Coleman, because Djibril Sidibe came in the League Cup. He's looks as though he's sort of hitting some sort of fitness where he's a real live option for Marco Silva. How much pressure do you think is Coleman under right now?
A bit of pressure, you know, as you say, bringing in Sidibe, I think from Monaco. So, you know, you're talking about a player that has quality, but Seamus Coleman, you know, I can't speak highly enough of him. He's still a top quality player. He is probably the leader in that dressing room. He's the guy that, you know, certainly has a word to say to the other players when they don't meet his standards, which is terrific. You know, to have met the young man when he was in 2009, I think, when he first came across, he was shy and timid and certainly not the character he's become. And it's great to have seen that he's now Everton captain, a leader, and justifiably so. And I think he's got another couple of seasons in the Everton first team. Certainly as captain, he'd probably be managed a little bit better now he's getting a bit older, but you know, he'd certainly be my first choice fullback.
Do you think Marco Silva will be able to ride this one out?
Well, the next few weeks are precious, really. You know, you look at the weekend, I don't think that, you know, too much. It's difficult to say. Everton have to perform against Manchester City, but there's not many people out there would expect Everton to beat Manchester City at the weekend. We're talking about an unbelievably good team. And then, you know, there's big fixtures, Burnley, West Ham, and I think Brighton come after that. And, you know, I think it's vital that at least two wins come out of these next four games. But, you know, as I've said before, Everton are capable of it. They've got some top quality players, a real attacking threat. I think Iwobi's really hit the ground running. He looks a good acquisition, even for the price. Him and Bernard are linking up well at the moment. Richarlison, as again, blows hot and cold, but can certainly get you the goals you need. And I think it's vital that those really take the games by the scruff of the neck and lead Everton forward.
Leon, great stuff. You don't have any video, do you, of that time Kev fell on his arse on the ice skating?
I think that was a time.
Do you
before.
Know what? I wish I did. Yeah. I so wish I did. I could describe it so vividly. I can see it in my mind. The moment he went into the air, but unfortunately, no, I've not got a video.
It's in slow motion, this perfect collapse.
I think it was just before the camera phones, the real video phones. I think that's what it was.
You got away with murder
that,
because of that, Kev.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Leon Osman, thanks a lot. We'll talk to you soon.
Cheers, Leon. Thanks, mate.
See you again.
Everton Man City this weekend. Our live game and Off the Ball on Sunday is Leicester against Newcastle. We'll take a quick break.
Off the Ball on News Talk.
For the lowest rate on the market for personal loans under 10k, with no early repayment fees and eligibility approval in seconds, try a loan that's fast and fair from OnPost Money. Maybe it's for sprucing up the back garden, upgrading the wheels, or the big family holiday. Whatever it's for, with OnPost Money, you know you're getting the lowest rate on the market for loans under 10k. Search OnPost Money Loans to apply online or visit your local post office. Lending criteria, terms and conditions apply. New applications only. Info correct as of 1st of August 2019. Source ccpc.ie. OnPost acts as a credit intermediary on behalf of Avantcard DAC. OnPost trading as OnPost Money is authorised as a credit intermediary by the CCPC. Avantcard DAC trading as Avantcard is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
International football is more exciting than ever.
Remember that first time on the terraces, where it all began. The heroes, the villains, the highs, the lows. All the while, you were learning. Now use that knowledge on Football Index. Join tens of thousands of fans trading the world's top players. Football Index, the game changed. App available, 18 plus, terms and conditions apply. Gamble responsibly.
This Irish success story is brought to you by Guaranteed Irish.
Who would have thought from humble beginnings in a small town butcher shop in the 1880s that Clonakilty black pudding would be exported around the world today? Supporting 50 jobs in the seaside town of West Cork, this family business and its famous recipe has become a local treasure, putting Clonakilty on the global food map. Guaranteed Irish helps you support companies that are altogether better choices for our communities. So look out for it. GuaranteedIrish.ie. Altogether better.
I'll place a full history check on black.
I'll put genuine parts on red.
I'm betting roadside assistance on green.
Buying a used Audi from an unauthorised dealer can be a gamble. But at Audi Approved Plus, all our used models come with a comprehensive warranty, free roadside assistance and more. Don't leave it down to luck. Test drive yours at your local Audi dealer today. Terms and conditions apply. Visit Audi.ie.
Celebrate our sale on October 2nd and 3rd with the Laser and Skin Clinic's amazing offers. Up to 50% off selected skin treatments, 30% off Cool Sculpting, our number one fat freezing treatment. Buy one, get one half price on all injectable treatments, dermal fillers, vampire facelifts and more. This October 2nd and 3rd only. Buy now, use later. Book now at laserandskin.ie.
Fly with Cathay Pacific from Dublin Airport to over 70 destinations across Asia and Australia and move beyond the familiar. State-of-the-art cabins, world-class entertainment and award-winning service, making sure you arrive ready to make the most of whatever lies ahead. Whether it's the stunning coastline of Sydney, the secluded waterfalls of Bali, or the bustling markets of Ho Chi Minh City, book now at cathaypacific.com. Cathay Pacific. Move beyond.
Switch and save at Carphone Warehouse. Save up to €189 on exclusive deals with three you won't find anywhere else. Get the Samsung Galaxy S10e or the Huawei P30 with a smartwatch GT for free. Yes, free. Both are available on a €45 a month plan with three, with all-you-can-eat data, but only when you switch at Carphone Warehouse. Any network, any phone, any plan. Only Carphone Warehouse. T's and C's apply. Offer subject to availability and 24-month contract.
Off the ball. This is News Talk.
All right, you're welcome back. Final part of Thursday's football show. Kev is still in studio. So we were talking about it earlier on, the Derby County statement and the news today, if you missed it, that Richard Keogh is going to miss the rest of the season following an incident that emerged last night where two of Derby County's players were arrested on a charge of drink driving. It turned out that Richard Keogh was in one of the cars. Initially, there were reports that he'd broken his wrist, but since then it turned out that he sustained a serious knee injury, which is going to prevent him from playing until the end of the season. Derby issued a very strong statement condemning the actions of Richard Keogh and of the players. Their manager, Philippe Cocu, went in front of the press earlier today. Here's what he had to say.
This is early stage to say it, but if we say he will be out for the rest of the season, it's a very serious injury, yeah, of course. Yeah.
And have you spoken to him? Do you know how he's feeling?
I've spoken, yeah, he was in there for a short moment, and I've spoken briefly, because there's a lot going on at the moment, of course.
How is he? What's his reaction?
He's extremely down, of course, yeah, because he realizes, yeah, what's going on for him personally, and of course as a responsible player, as a captain in the team, that he's not part of the team anymore, and then, yeah, of course that does something with the player.
You talked earlier about, you know, you left it to senior players to take responsibility. Does he feel that feeling that he should have been the person responsible for making sure nothing like this happened?
I think he feels responsible, yeah. Like I said, more senior players always have to step up and take responsibility, and now it's got a huge effect on him personally, and yeah, so it's a lot to deal with for him.
That is Philippe Cocu, the Derby County manager, talking about the situation. He has spoken with Richard Keogh, who's obviously in a bad way about this, and rightly so. He wasn't driving one of the cars, but he was there. Tom Lawrence and Mason Bennett both charged for alleged drink driving after a crash involving Lawrence's Range Rover on a club-sanctioned night out. club-sanctioned evening out, it seems. They went bowling, 8 o'clock, everyone went home. The club sort of did everything right. They laid on cars to bring the players home. That would be the right thing, I think, for any sort of work activity like this. Richard Keogh and several players decided, we're not going home, we're going to have a few drinks, and then clearly did something unforgivable. And Richard Keogh, I think it is too much to put the responsibility on him for the other players driving their car, as much as he was the senior figure. They're two young players and he's the senior figure. We don't know the exact details, but he is going to pay a huge price for this, regardless of any charges that are coming and what Derby County do. He's going to miss the rest of the season. He's 33 years of age. He was Mick McCarthy's man alongside Shane Duffy. And Mick McCarthy had said that. John Egan had started the season brilliantly. No, Duffy and Keogh have done nothing wrong. They are the centre-back partnership, and there's every chance that Ireland will qualify for Euro 2020, play their games in Dublin, and there's now every chance that he's going to miss that.
Yeah, exactly. The ramifications are huge for him personally in every way, and this is a sort of thing that could cost him his career. We don't know. We don't know how it's going to go for him if and when he does get back fit from this. So yeah, everything. It's a terrible story. That far too often over the years, the relationship between professional football and alcohol hasn't ended well. There's been too many stories that have emerged, and it's not many now. We have to say that now. Most of the things, like Derby, you said, Derby have done everything right. They've kept everything in house. It's been a few drinks at the right time. No real dramas were supposed to have happened, and then this happened, and that has always been the case. That's maybe been, at times, the culture of, just one more, maybe overstep the mark a little bit. And the lads here have overstepped the mark in such a big way. It's, as I said, you said earlier on, you cannot condone what's happened. And not Richard Keogh, you're saying that, yes, wasn't driving. Legally, he's done nothing wrong.
No, he's not going to face any charges
But we know, as captain, and that real experienced player that's within that dressing room, this should not have happened. And that's where, as I said, it's the sort of thing that could define his career. I hope it doesn't. And I'm sure, knowing of him, I know him a little bit, I don't really know him awfully well, but attitude was something that would have always been said to me. He's first class, rarely ever injured, always on the training ground, always leads by example. And it's just a mess, isn't it? It's a bad situation.
It does mean, from a footballing point of view, and it's secondary at the moment, but it'll become very much of the focus over the coming weeks. Mick McCarthy names his squad on Tuesday for the trips to Georgia and Switzerland. The strength has been that back five. They started every game so far. He's now going to be going to Tbilisi without Enda Stevens suspended, and it seems without both Richard Keogh and Shane Duffy. Now, it's worked out quite well in that he started Kevin Long and John Egan in the last friendly, but still, the two of them together are so untested.
Definitely. And I think it probably puts a little bit more emphasis on somebody like Glenn Whelan that's going to play ahead of those as the defensive partnership as well. That, take Glenn out the side now, we don't have a lot of experience really throughout the team, serious experience. And Seamus Coleman, should I say. Seamus Coleman will be part of that back four, and you're going to rely on him as well. But I'd say more of someone like Glenn Whelan that's going to have to sit, they're going to have to do a disciplined job in both those games. So there is going to be more of an emphasis on him now, and I think he has taken that on anyway. He's taken that mantle on, but it's you're right in saying that. That has been, I think, it's been the hallmark, or certainly our strongest point in the last few years, our defensive unit and how we've played and how we've beaten teams. It's always been by the odd goal. If we're going to win a game, we're not going to go and blow a side away 2-3-0. So it has to be about how we're going to keep sides out. So this is. It is a blower, yes, of course it is, but I just hope we've got enough within that squad to get through the two games and manoeuvre them well.
Yeah, Mick McCarthy will obviously have to talk about this on Tuesday. We'll bring you that on Tuesday night's show. OTB AM back tomorrow morning from 7:30 on our social channels on OTB Sports Radio at offtheball.com. Adrian Barry in studio, Owen Sheehan live from Japan. Are you back in the morning again?
Yeah, I am, unfortunately.
You really are a media whore, aren't you? Late tomorrow night.
Yeah, but
probably the BBC at the weekend. ITV then, this morning on Monday. Where'll he pop up next? We're back tomorrow from 7 on the radio. Johnny Murphy is in ahead of the Ireland-Japan game on Saturday. John Duggan and Tom Malone will be joined by jockey Chris Hayes, who won the Irish St. Ledger for Dermot Weld a couple of weeks back. So tune in for that from 7 tomorrow. Kev, thank you as always.
Great stuff.
Tom Dunn is up next. Enjoy that. Good luck.
Give him a ball and a yard of grass, he'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him
my ball and he had a spice. He'll give you moves with guilt like your eyes. Rat-tap-tap-tap-tap-tap-tap-tap. He's a nice young man. He's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man. He's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man.
Listen back to your favourite